Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
So I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to pray. If you're able to, would you just join me in prayer? And let's stand together if you can't. And let's just go before the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for the opportunity, first and foremost, that we have to be here in the house. Lord, we don't take it for granted that we have the freedom and ability to come and to worship you, Lord, without fear of persecution when thousands around the world are being heavily persecuted for their faith. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with here in this house. Lord, we don't come into this place to hear from a man or from a woman, from the old or from the young or anything like that. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you. And Lord, we fully expect that, or we fully acknowledge that it's Jesus that's the senior leader of this house. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we would ask your precious Holy Spirit to be our counselor today, would be our guidance, Lord, that you would show us the Word of God and cause it to be alive and powerful in our lives. Lord, bring to remembrance those that we need to remember and that which we need to remember today. Lord, we thank you that your word would be like a seed planted into our lives and our hearts being the ground. And Lord, as we leave this building and become your church and reflect your glory, Lord, I pray that it would bear much fruit for your kingdom. Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. And no time do we think of ourselves ever as better than anybody else or higher than anybody else, but rather we are co-laborers in the body of Christ working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, today we ask that you would bless your churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that you would set your hand upon our Catholic brothers and sisters and our denominational brothers and sisters, like the Lutherans and the Baptists and the Presbyterians and the Four Square denomination. Lord, we thank you that your hand would be upon all the local churches in the area, churches like Harvest and the Well and the Way. Lord, we thank you for Sandals and Ecclesia. Lord, we thank you for Water of Life and Emmanuel Baptist and Crossroads and New Creation. And Lord, Trinity and Victory. Lord, we thank you for all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we are all many members of one body, that is the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So, Father, to you be the praise and glory and the honor. And, Lord, we say that your kingdom come, Lord, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said, amen. Well, praise God. If you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Hebrews as we continue our study. In the book of Hebrews, how many guys got your Bibles here in church today? Right on. How many guys have your digital versions? I love how Paul DeYoung, he was here on Wednesday night, was talking about that. He thought that it was I thought it was the Shekinah glory over the congregation, but it turned out just to be the reflection of everybody's devices and their screens shining on them. And, you know, we're so blessed to be able to have the gospel of Jesus Christ in so many forms and fashions and translations at our fingertips. It's just an amazing opportunity, so let's not overlook that and get into the Word of God today. Before we get started, I just want to take a quick moment just to give you a plug. And the reason I'm going to do this is oftentimes you'll hear us from the pulpit say that last week's message was good or you need to get this or you need to get that. But the truth is if you did not hear what Pastor Jim talked about last week, you need to hear it. You need to go and get the CD after service in the CD counter, or you need to go home and download it, put it on your phone or put it on your computer, whatever it might be. Listen to it on your way to work. Listen to it while you're driving, whatever it might be. Sit down and listen to it. And the reason I say that is a very important message for the church that we have got to get a hold of and we have got to live and apply in our lives. And normally we say that, man, last week's message was great, but I'm telling you without a shameless plug, without feeling bad about it, the truth be told, you need to listen to last week's message from Pastor Jim. And if you haven't heard it, go get it, listen to it over and over and over again. And I'll tell you what, your life will never be the same. This morning, I want to continue in our subject of the book of Hebrews. The title of this morning's message is Forgetfulness, the Human Condition. Forgetfulness, the human condition. Now, before we get started, I want to give you a disclaimer because there's nothing more discouraging as a preacher than to preach a message about one subject and have somebody come and tell me, man, that was totally great. I'm going to apply it to something that had nothing to do with what you were talking about. I remember a long time ago, when we were in the book of Hebrews, I believe it's in the third chapter, talking about encouraging each other while we have today, I was talking about utilizing today. And it was a family member of mine says to me, man, that was a really neat message. You know, I'm going to learn to play the guitar because of that. And it was like, I was talking about encouraging the saints. And he's like, carpe diem, man. And it's like, okay. So the message of the title of the message is forgetfulness, the human condition. Listen, we've all forgotten recipes. We've all forgotten directions. We've all forgotten things that somebody's told us. We've forgotten stories. We've even forgotten memories. I don't want to speak today about your physical condition of memory. What I want to talk about is the Christian condition or the human condition of forgetting what God has done, what God has said and what God will do in our lives. So before we even get started, I want to lay that disclaimer that when we're talking about the subject of forgetfulness, that we are discussing the subject of forgetting what God has done in our lives. So as we look in the book of Hebrews in the 10th chapter, picking off right where we left off last week, Hebrews in the 10th chapter, beginning in verse number 32. Verse number 32 says, "But recall the former days." Now I'm going to read all the way through verse 34 so that we can see this entire sentence in its context. But here in the very beginning, the exhortation to the church is to recall the former days, to look back. This is where we're going to focus on today. This is what we're going to look at today. But let's read on in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. "Recall the former days in which you were illuminated," or you were enlightened or brought into the body of Christ. "You endured a great struggle with sufferings." Verse number 33 says, "Partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations," or hard times, "and partly while you became companions to those who were so treated." Verse number 34, "For you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and enduring possession for yourselves in heaven." This is really an amazing exhortation to the church and a really interesting thought, because here in the beginning of this sentence, this is all being one thought together. Here in the beginning of this sentence or this thought, the author of Hebrews exhorts the church to recall the former days, to look back, to think back on what you've gone through, what you've been through, and how you've made that. But at the end of this very thought, it says, understanding that you have something to look forward to understand that you have a past that you have come from, but also that you have a future in God. And we have got to understand that in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 32, where we're going to focus on today is to recall the former days. I remember I was in our young adult service and I was setting up my guitar before one of our services. I was going to play in the worship band that night. And one of our guitar players, very talented and gifted individual, says to me, "Pastor Luke, as a pastor, what is the most interesting thing you have ever seen?" And in hindsight, I realized that he was looking for, you know, maybe something like along the lines of, "Oh, I remember one time I was in Peru and I laid hands on somebody and they had a tumor on their neck and literally we felt the tumor dissolve." Or I remember there was a deaf lady that she heard after a healing service and she cried out because it was the first time she'd ever heard in her life. Or I've seen a blind person. I think he was looking for that. But I looked at this young man and I said, "You know what? The most interesting thing I've seen as a pastor is how fast people forget." You see, as a pastor, what I do is all around and involved around people. Everything that I do in my day-to-day operations and my day-to-day duties, it revolves around people and investing in and sowing into people. And because of that, we get to see some amazing things. We see people come and give their heart to the Lord, and we see people come and see their lives changed and restored by what God has done and what God is doing in their lives. But at the same time, we also see the negatives of that. We see people that are founded in the Word of God, and eventually as life unfolds and as things happen in their life and as they grow in their things of in life, you know, they begin in the front row and then they move to the back or to the middle, and then they move further and further back and then off to the side and closest to the exit, and eventually you see them leaving early, and then you see them once a month, and then you see them once every 3 months, and it's like, if we could just remind people of, man, if you could only remember where you came from that brought you here. And so what happens is we forget what God has done. We forget what God has said, and we forget what God will do in our lives. And because of that, we get wrapped up in the world around us. And so today I want to talk about the human condition of forgetfulness and what you and I can do to overcome that, to get beyond that, to grow past that, to what God has desired for us, to remember Him, to recall what God has done in our lives. And so today we're going to look at this. But before we get into how we can get beyond this condition, let's take a quick look at some things that would cause us to forget. Why do we forget? Some simple thoughts here of why you and I forget. I'm sure there's many more, but here's just a few for us this morning. Why do we forget? First thought is focus. Our focus changes. So often we get busy. We don't have time. We're going from one thing to the next thing to the next thing. Or we're so focused on what tomorrow has, or our business plans, or our future, or what the weekend has, that we get so wrapped up in our focus that we no longer give time or attention to pay attention to what God has done, to what God is doing or has said, and what God will do. So our focus gets wrapped up. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his churches, and he says to one of his churches, he says, "This I have against you, that you have forgotten your first love." You see, you've gotten so wrapped up in your own stuff. You've gotten so wrapped up in what you see as important that you have forgotten the very reason you came to Christ and what you are doing in your life. And so Jesus exhorts the church to come back and realize what God has done. So why do we forget? Focus is one of those things. Another thing that causes us to forget is fraud. We forget because of fraud. You could even say it like this, deceit. When we allow the enemy in our lives a place or a foothold, when we allow the influence of the enemy to speak into our lives, the Bible says that the devil, Jesus says that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And he will literally lead us by way of deceit, by way of fraud, to another direction, causing us to forget what God has doing, blinding our eyes to see what God has done or what God is saying in our lives. And we are literally taken away by the very essence of fraud from the devil, from the enemy, that we are robbed of what God has desired for us in our own lives. So why do we forget? Well, we forget because of focus. We forget because of fraud. Here's another one. We forget because of feelings. Has anybody in this place ever been offended? It's okay to say yes. I'm not going to scold you for it. You can't believe you've been offended. No, I'm just kidding. We have feelings. I remember in January, Jenya was here from Ukraine, and he was talking about emotions, irrational feelings that don't pertain to logic. So many times we've been offended. We've held bitterness in our lives. Well, God, I prayed for this and it didn't happen. God, I was believing for this and you didn't come through. Or God, that person in the church said this. Or Lord, I was in Stater Brothers and I saw the pastor two aisles over and he gave me a dirty look. And we have this offense or this bitterness, or we harbor onto these feelings. And literally what that does is it closes the door of our memory to what God has done, what God wants to do, and what God is saying. And we begin to focus on that feeling, or we begin to focus in on that offense. So it literally causes us to forget. So why do we forget? Focus, fraud, feelings. How about this one? Our flesh. I love it. You hear a lot of preachers say nowadays, you know, sometimes we give the devil too much credit. Amen. We're guilty too. We have a flesh body. We have a flesh nature. We have a desire. And so often what happens is we get wrapped up focusing in on ourselves, focusing in on our desires, focusing in or looking in at and taking care of what we want to do, thinking about what we want to think about, doing what we want to do, that we don't give ourselves time or the allotment or the ability to focus in or to remember or to recall what God has done. So literally through our selfishness, we forget what God has done. So why do we forget? Focus, fraud, feelings, flesh. How about this one? Fulfillment. So often in Christianity, somebody will come and say, man, we come to God in our time of need and we cry out to God, God, I need you. God, I need you to succeed in my business. God, I need you to succeed in my finance. Lord, I need you to bless my children. Lord, I need my relationship or my marriage to be restored. And we believe God and we seek after God and we focus after God. But then as things become good, as we grow content, as our businesses begin to flourish, or as our relationships begin to be mended, or our children, we see them succeeding in life, then all of a sudden we grow happy and content, and we no longer focus on what has happened or what God is saying, but now we say, well, now I'm good. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that a great story about King Solomon. David, his father, said, if you remember all that I have told you, your kingdom will last. But at the end, and as the days of Solomon grew, and as wisdom grew, and as his notoriety grew, and as his wealth grew, he became content in his life. And the Bible tells us that his heart was turned away from God. And literally, his son ripped the kingdom in half. We can grow content and forget what God has done. So why do we forget? Focus, fraud, feelings, flesh, fulfillment. One more for this morning. Why do we forget? Fights, trials, tribulations, hard times. We get wrapped up in our pain. We get wrapped up in the suffering. We get into this, woe is me. God, why would you allow this to happen to me? How can this be happening to me right now? It's our condition, our nature to seek out those who are going through what we're going through. You've heard the phrase, misery loves company. It's easier to complain than it is to resolve the problem. And so we get so wrapped up in complaining, we get so wrapped up in focusing on the pain or the trials or the hardships of what we're going through that we forget what God has done, we forget what God has said, and we forget what God will do in our lives, and we focus in on our trials and we find ourselves in a place that God does not desire for us to be. So here we've looked at some reasons as to why we forget. I know that there's so many that we could even look at, and there's more that we can talk about. But today I want to move beyond why we forget after we've laid the foundation as to what we can do in order to not. But before I do, I want to lay the challenge on you and on me. You see, it's in our human condition. Nobody can remember everything. There's not one person that has remembered everything in life. So you can take a deep breath and say, all right, whew, it's okay to forget some things in life. But here is the challenge for you and I. That it is our responsibility to remember God in all seasons, in all walks, in all aspects of our lives. Let me put it like this. Nobody can make you, nobody could make me remember what is my responsibility to remember. You've probably been there before, telling a story or talking to somebody. Man, you and I were here. Do you remember that? No, man, Well, dude, it was on a Monday, it was Friday, or you know, it was like this, the weather was like that, you were wearing a red shirt. No, man. And they said, no, man, I don't remember. No matter what you do, even if you remind them and tell the story back to them, you cannot make them remember. You see, nobody can make us not forget. It is our responsibility. That is the challenge or the weight that is placed upon our shoulders. It is our responsibility to remember God. In Deuteronomy, the fourth chapter, Moses' sermon to the Hebrews or the Israelites here, or the children of Israel as they're going, as it's time to move on, as he's reminding in Deuteronomy, the fourth chapter, verse number 9, Moses says, and he says this, he says, only take heed to yourself. Do you know what take heed means? Work at it. Be diligent. Put some effort into it. Let me give you the antonym or the opposite of take heed. Be lazy. Do nothing. Don't even think about it. So here Moses is saying, work hard, do something, put an effort to diligently keep yourself. Listen to this. Why? Lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen. And lest they depart from you all the days of your life. And it goes on and even further and it says, and teach them to your children and your grandchildren. Why? Because we have got to learn that when God is faithful to us, when God is faithful to the generation previous to us, to the generation that was previous to them, that God is faithful to them, that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and will be faithful to us. The travesty is hundreds of years later, the time of Gideon. The Bible tells us that the children of Israel no longer remembered what God had done for them. And now they're finding themselves in a season of oppression and they're literally hiding in caves and in holes from their oppressors. You see, if we allow ourselves to forget, the world will come. Life will unfold. Opposition will present itself. And if we forget what God has for us, we will find ourselves hiding in holes, hiding in caves against what God has. When God says, my desire for you churches to be more than conquerors. That's our challenge. It's our mandate. It's our responsibility from God. But let me tell you something. Let me give you a sigh of relief that even though we have a challenge, we have a weight on our shoulders, we have a relief. On Friday, I was playing my guitar with the worship band before the service. I just wanted to worship with them. So I brought over my guitar, just was playing and listening, and we were having a good time. And afterwards, I said, man, I'm preaching on tomorrow, and I got to take my guitar, and I got to take my amp, and I got to bring it back over here to the office where I store it, and I hold on to it. And I'm thinking, man, this is heavy. I pick it up, and I look at my guitar and my guitar pedals and stuff like that. And I said, oh, I got to come all the way back. I got to go. I'm tired, and I got to come all the way back and get all this stuff. And as I'm walking, a young man walks up to me and he says, hey, Pastor Luke, Let me help you with that. Praise God. Relief. You see, you and I have a responsibility on our shoulders, but we have a relief given to us by God to know that we are not alone in our responsibility. If you have your Bibles, go to me the book of John in the 14th chapter. John in the 14th chapter. What a really neat section of scripture. Oftentimes, if you're wondering, man, I just wonder what I should read, or I'm opening up my Bible for a devotion, what should I read? Turn to John the 14th chapter. It's great. 15th chapter is right on there with it. John the 14th chapter, Jesus is encouraging his disciples. In verse number 26, Jesus says this. John the 14th chapter, verse number 26, he says, "But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, the Helper, the Holy Spirit," that says, "Hey, can I help you?" The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things. And listen to this. And he will bring to remembrance all things that I have said to you. Praise God, we have help in remembering what God has said, what God has done, and what God will do. One of the very functions of the Holy Spirit is to remind you and I of God's goodness in our lives. So here now we have this challenge to remember what God has done. Now let us look for the last couple of minutes this morning on what we can do so that we do not forget. How to not forget. Some simple thoughts for this morning. How to not forget. First thought for this morning is to set a memorial. Now, when you think of memorial, you probably think of what I think of a memorial. I think of sad, somber, somebody died. So, you know, it's like on the TV or in the movies, everybody's wearing black. It's always raining, you know. But let me tell you what a memorial, as it's literally defined, is. A memorial is something established, especially to remind people of a person or an event. Something that is established, especially to remind people of a person or an event. A memorial is simply this, a reminder. Something that you see that says there was a battle here, or there was a victory here, or this person stood for something, or this person did something. That's why in Washington, D.C., it's full of memorials. Why? So that we would remember what it took for us to be this great nation that we are. And you see, all throughout the Old Testament, the Bible, in the Bible, God instructs his people to set up memorials for the specific reason that they would not forget what he has done. One of the greatest examples is the Passover. As the angel of the Lord came and took the firstborn of those in Egypt and passed over those who had painted the blood of an innocent lamb over their door, God says and instructs his people, "I want you to hold a feast every year to remind you of what God has done, that God has spared you and delivered you." In the Bible, in the book of Joshua, God is instructing Joshua. He says, "Joshua, I want you to grab 12 men from Israel." As they're entering into the promised land, finally it's time, and they take the Ark of the Covenant, and the priests there go before, and the moment they step on the banks of the great Jordan River, the water goes from side to side, and the ground becomes dry. And they cross over the Jordan River on dry land, just like they crossed out of Egypt on dry land. And God says to Joshua, "I want you to take 12 men, one from each of the tribes of Israel, and I want you to go and tell them to get a rock out of the river where they crossed." Now, you know when God says to get a rock, God's not saying, "Oh, there's a rock. Got one." Right? Okay, God's saying, "I want you to go get a rock. A real one." So, you know, these guys are going and they're picking this up and throwing it. "No, don't fall." Okay. And God says, "I want you to take that rock and place it where you camped that night." So as Joshua is instructing his people to choose 12, one from each of the tribes of Israel to get this rock, he explains why in Joshua, the fourth chapter, verse number 6. And he says that this may be a sign among you when your children asking time to come, saying, what do these stones mean to you? The Jews shall answer them, and you shall answer them, that the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. When it crossed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. And he says, and these stones shall be a memorial to the children of Israel forever. A continual, constant reminder that God was with them. Church, God's desire for us is to set up memorials in our life that we would remember so that we would not forget what God has done. Oftentimes you may have heard of Pastor Jim talking about where he was or where he came from. And I remember growing up, there was a blue license plate with yellow words or yellow letters that said MATT633. And it was Dad's license plate on his car. And even after that car was long gone, that license plate was displayed on the garage so that every time we came and every time we left, we would see that if we sought first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things shall be added unto you. When my wife and I, we poured the slab for our patio in our backyard, at every door, at every exit of our house, on every corner of our patio, we took a nail and we inscribed scriptures in the wet cement. And we wrote the references down so that every time we stepped out of our house onto the patio, we would have a memorial, a reminder of Matthew 6:33, of Joshua 24:15, as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. Even after we are long gone from that house, in the cement of that patio, the memorial will be remembered. So we've got to set up things that would cause us to remember what God has desired and what God has said and what God will do. How to not forget, number two, to meditate on God. Now, I know what you're thinking. I talked about memorial. You were thinking a funeral. Meditate, you're thinking of sitting Indian style on the ground and humming. Let me tell you what meditating is. Meditation, literally defined, is to think deeply or to focus for a period of time. Meditate on God, to think deeply or to focus on God for a period of time. We get so busy, we get so wrapped up, we get so involved in everything that's going on around us that by the time it's time to go to bed, we're exhausted and we lay down and we never give God any moment or any time in our lives. And we've got to set time aside to focus, to think deeply on what God has done. A couple of weeks ago, I took some guys up to the Eastern High Sierras for a little retreat. And we drove up to 395, and some of the guys that were in my car, they got like the scenic version, and I was like the tour guide. And I was pointing, see that mountain over there? That mountain is called this, and this is the reason it was called that. And see how this one is black, and that one is, and see, look at the different rocks over here. That's actually from this kind of a rock, and this one erupted 800 million years ago. And over there in the hills, there's a ghost town that doesn't exist anymore, and they used to mine this, and this is the shootout that happened over there. And they're just like, dude, how do you know all this stuff? Well, because I like that drive. That's probably my favorite place on earth. And every time I drive, I'd pick up the little tour guide and read. Wow, I didn't know that. And I would focus and I would give attention and I would give time to read that. But did you know that putting time or putting focus or giving effort to learn something, especially as useless as a town in 1850 that doesn't even exist today on the Highway 395 in the desert of California, is senseless, useless information. But when we focus and meditate on what God has done, it is never senseless, nor is it ever useless. We spend time thinking upon what God has done. In Psalms, the 77th chapter, it's a psalm of Asaph, and in the first 10 verses, he's talking about the trials and the hardship and the tribulation that he's gone through and the oppression that he's dealing with and all that's pressing against him. And in verse number 10 in Psalms, the 77th chapter, it says this, and I said, this is my anguish. I've laid it out. I've let it be known. This is what I'm going through, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. Verse number 11, he goes on and he says, I will remember the works of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old. And verse number 12, he says, I will also meditate on all your work. See, God's desire for us is to spend time focusing on what he has done, on what His Word says and on what He will do. Remember Hebrews in the 10th chapter. Recall back and look forward at the same time. How to not forget, meditate on God. How to not forget, set a memorial. Number three, how to not forget, marriage to Christ. Last week, Pastor Jim says, you know, preachers say, it's not about religion, it's about relationship. Guilty, been there before, but he was so right. Why? Because each and every one of us have relationships in our life that we know. We look at that person or we look at that and we say, man, I need to give attention to that. I need to work on my relationship, and yet we do nothing for it. It's not just about a relationship. You see, it's about a marriage relationship. The most intimate of unions between a man and a woman on this earth is God's union of marriage. It's the most intimate relationship a human being can enter into. And God says, that is my desire for a relationship with you. The Bible describes us as the bride, the church, as the bride of Christ. Jesus, all throughout his parables, references the bridegroom. And in Ephesians, the 5th chapter, he speaks of husbands and wives and gives them the example by leading them in the example of a physical marriage by the relationship of Jesus and the church. Ephesians in the 5th chapter, verse number 24, Paul the Apostle, as he writes to the church, he says, therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so should wives be to their own husbands and everything. You know, we say that. We say, wives, be submissive to your husbands. That's not like, oh, man, I gotta listen to what he says. You know why? Because we don't say that about Jesus. Oh man, I gotta serve Jesus. We're glad to. We're excited to, because he has pulled us out. Why? Because we remember where we've come from. Verse number 25, it goes on and it says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for you. Doesn't give the position of a husband to rule over, to reign over. Well, I'm the man, woman. Because Jesus loved and gave himself for the church, for you and I. So he paints this picture of love in a marriage union, and his desire, God's desire, is for us to be married to Christ in our relationship, so intimate with each other that we know each other's intimate feelings and thoughts towards each other. The Bible says in Jeremiah, for I know the plans and thoughts I have for you. God wants to share them with us. But we have got to be united. You see, a relationship without communication, a relationship without a time spent is not a good or healthy relationship. What's the most important thing a marriage can be trusted or be based on is trust. Where does trust come from? Past experiences. As you get to know each other, you realize that I can give them my dreams. I can place them, their life or my life, in their hands. I can have children with them and know that they will be with me. And as we grow in our relationship with God, our trust grows because we base it on past experiences. Guess what? That we remember. With God, his desire for us is to have a marriage relationship with Jesus. Last one for this morning. How to not forget. Last one. This is a really neat one too. Is to be a messenger. Be a messenger. To shout it out. To proclaim it, to share the word of God, the testimony of what God has done, not just in your life, but in the lives of those who are around you. It's cool to share somebody else's testimony. Because it is something, it is, God has wired inside of humanity something to hear the testimonies of what God has done. You see, when we can share, we can sit around the campfire and talk about days of old. Oh man, do you remember when we did this and we were crazy kids and that person, they yelled at us and they chased us, and everybody's laughing. And you can tell that story every day till you're blue in the face, and guess what will happen? And that story will become redundant. It'll become repetitive. Your friends will start to say, yeah, man, you already told us about that. We talked about that. But did you know that your testimony, that what God has done, will never be redundant? It will never be repetitive. It'll never be useless in sharing. When we went away to Bible college, we were the last graduating class that was able to sit underneath Kenneth Hagin Sr., a great, mighty man of God, did some wonderful and amazing works. And it was a privilege to sit under his class. And I remember as he would teach and he would come, the class would just stand in awe and reverence as he would walk into the class, and we would just sit, and he would sit on his stool And he would just start to tell his stories. Well, I remember it was 1954, and I was driving down, and we would, okay, you know. And then we would go to another class about a completely different subject, and he would sit down on a stool. Well, I remember it was 1954, and then it would be like camp meeting or this big like conference or something like that, and he would sit, and everybody would listen on the edge of the chairs. What is this man of God going to say? Well, I remember it was like 19, and after a while, we're kind of like, all he does is tell the same stories. But then what happened is we began to listen. And every time he would share a story, every time he would share a testimony, every time he would tell us something that we already knew or we had already heard, I would get something different out of it. I would get a little nugget here. I'd get a little treasure there. Oh man, I didn't hear that before. I didn't realize this happened before, or this little aspect of the story over there. And it would strengthen us and encourage us. And as students graduating out of Bible college, getting ready to go into the ministry, we were equipped, we were empowered, we were encouraged, because God was faithful to him. God will be faithful to us. Psalms. In the 96th chapter, verse number 3, says, declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. Instead of gathering around the water cooler on Monday morning, talking about what happened on the weekend, and did you see what happened on TV, or did you see what Beyonce's doing, or whatever, something else is going on, let's gather together and start being messengers of what God has done, what stories we've heard. Man, you should hear what God is doing in Asia. You should hear what God is doing in Africa. I heard from this preacher from the Middle East, and he was talking about this. Let me tell you what God is doing, and what that serves to do as encourage and build and strengthen the body of Christ, to remember that God is good. And the Bible tells us in 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter, this young boy, David, goes before the mighty, the great King Saul, the Saul who the Bible describes as a head above everybody else, the one that stood up when everybody else bowed down. Saul was this great, mighty leader, and here is this teenage boy before the king of Israel, pleading on behalf of God to allow him to be the sole representative in a one-on-one fight to the death against Palestine's or Philistine's greatest warrior. And he convinces the king of Israel, the subject of the term was whoever lost that army would be now slaves to the other. And here is this teenage boy that allows, or that convinces this great mighty king of Israel, the first king, to allow him to be the sole representative with nothing more than a slingshot and some rocks. Why? Because he says to the king, it was God who delivered me from the hand of the lion, or the mouth of the lion. It was God who delivered me from the mouth of the bear. And it is God who will deliver me from the hands of this uncircumcised Philistine. Because he was a messenger of what God has done, he was victorious in life. So the human condition is forgetfulness. We're prone to it. Spiritually speaking, it comes easy to us. But praise God, the Bible tells us that in Christ, we are new creations. Behold, the old is gone and passed away, and now we are a new creation, which means the human condition may be forgetfulness, but we are no longer a subject to the human condition. Now we live in the Christ condition. With the help of the Holy Spirit, we can remember what God has done and be victorious in life, which God has desired for us. Did you guys get something out of the word of the Lord this morning? Praise God. Hey, listen, before we leave, I want to do one thing. I want to ask everybody, please give me a moment more of your time. Don't get up, don't walk around. Give me a moment more of your attention. You see, it would be a travesty, it'd be a shame for us to have service, to worship God, to hear a message, and to leave on the assumptions that everybody in this building, everybody in this room is in the right position with God, when in reality there are those of us in this place, or those of you in this place, that need to get right with God. So let me ask you this question, and I want you to think about it and be honest with yourself. You see, nobody's going to know this answer except you and God, not your spouse or the person next to you or the person you came with, only you and God. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Relatively simple question. You know, oftentimes we think, man, yeah, I'm going to go. I want to go to heaven. Can I ask you this follow-up? What makes you so sure? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you hope, because you think, or because you want to get to heaven, you're going to go? That God looks upon us and says, man, they thought so hard. I think I can, that we're going to get in. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you have a positive outlook on life, that you're going to get into heaven, like this positive thinking kind of, you know, everybody, you know, self-betterment. It doesn't work like that. You know, oftentimes what happens is we hear, oh, well, you know, my parents baptized me as a baby. You know, my godfather and my godmother, you know, that they made a promise in my stead. Or I was christened, or I went to Sunday school or Sabbath school classes. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, you cannot find in the Bible that because you were baptized as a baby or because somebody made a promise or a guarantee on your behalf when you couldn't even make decisions on your own means that you're going to get into heaven? You cannot find that in the Bible. Oftentimes I think, well, because I sit in church, I'm here today, I hear the pastors preach. My parents took me to church on Christmas and on Easter growing up. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God will you find that because you have a gold star attendance at church means you're going to get into heaven? You can't find that. You can't see that because you attend church on Christmas, on Easter, you're here today, you're not going to get into heaven because of that. Well, Pastor Luke, I've always called myself a Christian. I believe, you know, that I'm a Christian. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you profess or because you've given yourself the title of a Christian, meaning you're going to get into heaven? It's not about giving yourself a name. You know, I can give myself a name. I could say that I'm a Dodger. I could go and buy a Dodgers uniform and go try to sit in the Dodgers dugout. But did you know that I'm not really a Dodger? Just because I call myself that, just because we call ourselves Christian doesn't mean that we're actually Christians. Well, but Pastor Luke, I'm a good person. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person? Nowhere in the Word of God will you read because you give to charitable organizations or because you try to help your fellow human out that you're on the path to heaven. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, are like filthy rags. Nothing you and I could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. You know, oftentimes we think, well, because I volunteer in children's ministry, I used to work at a church, or I served in the youth, or I sang in the choir, I was an usher. Doesn't that mean that I'm going to get into heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God is to say that because you're involved, because you volunteer, because you've worked at a church, or because somebody in your family member works at a church or is involved or is a pastor or something like that. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that means you're going to get into heaven? You can't get there. See, the reality is that you and I can't get to heaven our way. Why? Because it's God's heaven. It has to be God's way. And Jesus Christ is that way. Jesus says this. He says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do it any other way but God's way. You see, the problem is it's not about our outward actions. It's not about how good we look or how good we seem or what we try to do on the outside. God's standard for entrance into heaven is perfection. But the Bible tells us that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So by birth, we have fallen short of God's standard. So how then do we get there? Jesus Christ, as he was speaking to a man in the book of John in the 3rd chapter, a religious man. The Bible tells us this man, his name is Nicodemus, was a Pharisee and a leader of the Jews. That tells us that he was educated. That tells us that he had memorized the scripture. That tells us that he was a leader, a man of influence, a man who did good for other people, a man who taught in the synagogue or the church of his day. And Jesus says to Nicodemus regarding heaven's entrance, he says, you must be born again. You see, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always meant the same thing in the heart of God. Here it is. It means that you have given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. Doesn't mean what Hollywood's trying to make it out to be. Doesn't mean what society's trying to make born again Christians out to be. It simply means this. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. We talked about it today. A marriage with God. An intimate relationship. Let me show you in the Word of God. In the book of James, the Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know and believe that Jesus is the Son of God, yet they're not on their way to heaven. It's not about your carnal knowledge or your mental assent of who God is. Well, we say, well, you know, I know who Jesus is. I know John 3:16. I know that's why you're here today. God's after all of your heart, after all of your life. Let me show it to you in the Bible again. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to the church, and he says to the church, he's coming back. And when he comes back, he better find the church, us, hot or cold, because he says, if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Whoa, shocking statement. Jesus is saying that Christians, lukewarm Christians, will be rejected and ejected, counted as waste from the kingdom of God. What does lukewarm mean? Let's describe that. Let's define that today. Lukewarm simply means this in your relationship, that you're not wholehearted for God, that you're not wholehearted against God, that you're a little bit up in your relationship, but you're also a little bit down. You're a little bit in, but you're a little bit out. Not wholehearted, not whole commitment to God. occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You got one foot in church, one foot in the world. Jesus Christ says, if that's you, you are deceived in thinking you're going to make it into the kingdom of God. And I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough, and more importantly today, I honor God enough to tell you the truth. God, forgive us in American churches for watering the message down that we might think that we, because we attend church, because we pray a token prayer, because we do this, or because we give ourselves a title, that we're going to get into heaven. When in reality, God's desire for us is an all or nothing relationship with Him. So today I want to give you the opportunity. Jesus says these words. He says, if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. But if you deny Him, He will deny you. Today I want to give you the opportunity. Today I want to give you the opportunity to ensure your place with God in heaven forever and ever, leaving hell behind. We've got to get a right mindset of who God is. You see, God didn't come into this world to condemn men to hell. That's why we have John 3:17 when Jesus says, I have not come to condemn but to redeem. God is not like a little kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up. He's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to whack you over the head. He loved you so much, He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die a beaten, bloody mess on a cross, to hang naked for the world to see, to take our sin and our shame so that we could be reunited with God. And in return, He wants all of our hearts and all of our lives. And it starts with a decision. Today is the day of your salvation. It's a divine appointment. You've had doctor's appointments and dentist appointments and DMV appointments. Today is an appointment between you and God. And here's what I'm going to do in just a moment. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count to three, I'm going to go three. I'm going to smack my hand real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I smack my hand, here's what I want to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're just saying, hey, Pastor Luke, I want to get saved. Pastor Luke, I want to give God my heart. Pastor Luke, I want to make sure today I get into heaven. You see, I'm a man. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And you can put your hand right back down. You say, man, if I do that, I'm going to be embarrassed. Wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward with God, for God in a warm and welcome and loving place like the church? If you can't do that in here, how on earth do you expect to do it beyond these walls? You see, the decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. It's your choice, your will. It's a gift, the Bible says, eternal salvation. But you have got to make the choice to receive it. Who should raise their hands in just a moment? If you've never given God your heart, you've never given God your life, if that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Who should raise their hands? Maybe you did this at a Harvest Crusader, or you did this in the youth group or something like that, but you've never really followed up with it. You've forgotten where you've come from. If that's you, in just a moment, pop your hand up. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge you and put it right back down. Who should raise their hands? You've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. You've been running from God instead of to God. Today, let's make this the day you ensure your place with God in heaven forever and ever. Go hot in your relationship by giving Him all of your heart, giving Him all your life. It starts with your decision today. In just a moment, if that's you, pop your hand up. Wherever you're at, from the front rows to the back rows, you guys over there in the family rooms on each side, I'm talking to you with your families. If you're in the foyer or the church campus and you hear the sound of my voice, that's you I'm talking to. You at home, watching on your phone or on your computer, if that's you in this, you at home, you, I'm talking to you as well. This is the moment, this is the day of your salvation. I'm going to count to three all across this auditorium. If that's you, get ready, pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and we'll go forward from there. I'm going to count to three. Here we go. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four. I see that. Five, I see that hand. Six, seven, I see you right there. Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place? Where are you at in this place? Ushers, help me out on the sides. Eight, I see you back there in the back. Eight wise people. Anybody else on this side? Nine, 10, I see you right there. In the, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. I got you guys. A whole family right there. Praise God. 15 wise people in this place. 15 wise. Anybody else in this place? I see the ushers pointing over here. 15 wise people. Anybody else in this place? Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. You should. Anybody else? 15 wise people, 16 wise people. I see ushers pointing over there. Another one over there, 16. Hey, praise God for the 15, 16 wise people and those that I missed. I see you guys in the family rooms, 17, 18, 19. Praise God. Here's what we're going to do. You don't get saved by raising your hand. That's the first step. I said it starts with the first step. You say, I want to do this. Now it's time to follow through with the decision that you're making. And here's what we're going to do. In just a moment, we're all going to stand. I'm going to ask, please be polite. Nobody leave at this time as we stand in just a moment. And those of you that raise your hand, if you're in the family room, the ushers, they'll come and help you get your stuff. For those of you, whether you're in the front or the back, wherever you're at, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with somebody, say, hey, come with me, or look at them and say, I'll go with you. I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get in the aisle, and come meet me. I want to shake your hand. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand together. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on. This is your moment. This is your time. Come meet me right here.
Lord, I give you my heart.
Come on, you can come. That's you.
I'll give you my soul. And I'll live
for you. The family rooms in the back, wherever you're at. Come on, if that's you guys, you raise your hand. This is your moment.
And I take and every moment I'm away. Lord, have your my heart, I give my soul.
Come on, if that's you, wherever you're at, you come.
I'll live for you alone. Every breath that I take,
you can come.
Every moment I'm away. Lord, have your way.
Oh, they're still coming, we'll wait.
Lord, I give you my heart.
25, dear.
I give you my soul.
Enough is back. Right on.
Now live for
me. Look at you guys. They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you.
Every breath that I take.
Congratulations.
Every moment I'm away.
Come on. That's you.
Lord, have your way.
Praise God. Praise God. Hey, guys, hey, they're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. Praise God. Well, hey, guys, this is what I want to do. I want to just tell you a couple things. First of all, you're not going to a funeral. Hey, you're going to a birthday celebration. Today's the first day of the rest of your life. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. What he's going to do, he's going to take you guys right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on. I'm the weirdest preacher here, okay? So you made it through me, okay? He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You get saved by asking Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior, or the leader of your life, and you're going to ask him to come into your life, into your heart. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information, some literature. As you walk out of this place, you say, what do I do next? We're going to help point you in the right direction. And the third thing he's going to do is he's going to ask you or invite you to come back, hang out with us, sit down with somebody right before church service. They'll buy you a cup of coffee. They'll sit with you. They'll get you a soda, whatever it might be. Teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks there to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the way or to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in what God has for you. So if you would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.